stars are here. They are like actors. So these are actors on the stage. Okay, so now if we have to figure out where the actors are, we have to do one actor at a time, you know, each transcription factor at a time. However, what we can do is let's have a screen. Instead of seeing what transcription factor is there, you just see a shadow of a guy, an actor on stage, right? So you see, okay, these are the kind of, you can think of histomarks like a shadow on the stage. And you can see, okay, there are actors on here, but this actor is gone in another condition. Does that make sense? So on the screen, you don't know which actor it is, but at least you can see there's a shadow on the screen. Okay? So in the different conditions, you can see the signals are different. And so how is that useful? Because all of these transcription factors bind to the DNA with a motif. If you know where things are happening, you can use motif analysis afterwards to guess what transcription factors are binding in that location. Does that make sense? So for example, I'll show you the example here. Okay, so this is a small intestine, is our gut. Okay, so in the gut, these bottom cells are stem cells. They continue to divide. Okay, so these are still kind of early stage cells. And so every day, the new cells will push the old cells on the top. And these are more like stem cell-like. But these are more differentiated cell-like. And then they get older and older, and in a week's time, it's shed to the intestine. Okay? The food resides in here. These are our little villas in our intestine. And so the nutrients will be absorbed from here into the cell and then go into the bloodstream. Okay? So actually in the mouse gut, if you take the embryo, there are tiny little string, and you just shake, this thing will come off. You can actually profile the histomarks on the top and the bottom separately. And you can look at them and see in some locations, you can see. So there are some regions in the genome, in the progenitor cells, there are regions like this. You can think of it like this many years. That means a transcription factor is active in the progenitor cells. And then in the differentiated cells, they are gone. They are like much, much weaker, right? And if we do, because in the genome there are thousands of such regions, if we collect those regions that have this shape, that was high here in the progenitor but low in the differentiated, you can collect a few thousand regions like this. You can do motif analysis in the middle to ask what kind of motif is there. And actually from this, we can actually see transcription factor motifs in this region. And this is some work we published with Ramesh Dasani's lab, and they were very excited when they saw the motif. Like, oh, these are all the ones that they kind of knew that are important for gut development. But there are also cases where, you know, in a progenitor cell, you have this little weak signal, but you can differentiate it, suddenly you see a strong one here. Okay, that would mean a transcription factor was probably low in here, but suddenly get activated in the differentiation, the differentiated cells, and if we do motif analysis, you will also see a whole bunch of transcription factors motif in there. Okay? The interesting thing there is there are transcription factors, like this guy. It's high on both. I'm like, what happened to this? Right? It's strong in these ones, but also in this, what's going on? It turns out for this transcription factor, depending on its partner, it will go to a different place in the different cells. So in the stem cell or the kind of progenitor compartment, these two transcription factors, because GATA6 is high also in the stem cell compartment, when you interact together, they have a better way of going to the binding site. And then they will go to a lot of these binding years in the progenitors. Okay? And if you look at their nearby gene, we can do gene ontology of their target gene later on, you can see, okay, they are related to embryonic and organ development, so more like stem-like functions. But in the differentiated cells, in the villus area, these two will interact together. And if you look at their nearby genes, they are more related to metabolism, absorption, or you know, gut kind of functions, or like gut intestine type of functions. Okay, so you can see it's the same initial transcription factor, but when they interact with different partners in the different cells, they will go to a different place. And we can identify those. Initially, you don't have to even know this. You just look at the histomer changes. You know, basically what we did in this case is, you know, we have a profile of the shadows in the progenitor cells and a profile of the shadows in the differentiated cells, and look at the places where the shadows change. We say that's where the actions are. And so we focus on the motif analysis of those either lost or the gained ones, right? There are some lost and some gained. And then you figure out what are the transcription factors that might be relevant in that cell. Sam?
Would the analysis be able to distinguish between, you know, the second mark along that, and it's like a, on the top it's big and on the bottom it's small?
So this depending on how you implement your algorithm. Do you need a yes, no, or you need a quantitative difference, right? And so this actually has been done now a lot more. In the early days, we were kind of among the earlier ones, but a lot of people are using a similar approach. You just profile the histomer, and then you use the motif on the histomer location that have big changes to figure out what factor is important there. And very often, that's also associated with a K27 acetylation change at the gene, at the promoter of the gene. And you can see this gene going up and down. Okay? Let's see. Yeah, so that's one important area of application. Questions about using histomer for figuring out the enhancers and transcription factors? So I would say I started my PhD back in 1997 when the motif database was not so great. That's why my early work was on motif, right? And now we do know in the order of probably close to 1,000 transcription factor motifs. So with this many motifs already known, if you just see the shadows change, you look at which motifs are enriched in those locations where the histomer gained or lost, you will be able to make a fairly accurate guess what transcription factors are important. There it is.
So in the previous slide, when you had the shadows, that was just one line, or maybe before that.
Well, so whether you can see this very, very clearly depending on how you did your ChIP-seq experiment. So if your ChIP-seq fragments are very long, just it's like sonication, right? If your fragment is long, what you might just see is that, let's just still keep this, okay? This is when your ChIP-seq, you sonicate, when you use MNAs to digest your fragment to shorter fragment, then you will be able to see the nucleosome. But if your fragment is pretty long, you will just see this region in one condition is low, and in another condition is very high. It will just be one signal. It depends on the resolution.
So also, like, would that be the equivalent of you running those multiple experiments on different histone markers?
No.
Or just one?
It's just one histomer. Because, okay, so this experiment is run on a histomer that tells us something about enhancers. What are the marks that are on enhancers? Because enhancers are the more important thing about regulating gene expression. It's kind of the most important thing about regulating gene expression. Whereas some other marks, they're marking the massively suppressive regions, say K9 trimethylation. They're kind of stamping out the repetitive sequence in the genome. They don't really change that much in this type of small stimulation type of experiment. Okay? Then they're not as informative. That's why out of all the marks, when you want to try many different cells, people usually just focus on one or two. K27 acetylation is like the most useful mark.
And last one, how expensive is an experiment like this usually?
Ah, interesting. Depending on how many you do. For example, right now at the Broglie Institute and at our center at Dana-Farber, we can do these on robots, on 96 well plates, right? So if you grow the cells, you send us, if you do one, you have to run the machine once. But if you do 96 well plate, it's much cheaper. I would say like less than $2,000, something like that. Okay. Right now, in terms of technique for chip seq, people are trying to also lower the cell needed. You know, like very often when you do a chip seq, it's oh, you don't have enough cells. Like you take an embryo, you know, this little something. How do you do this from 10 million cells to 1 million to 100,000 cells or even 5,000 cells? That's actually where the technique is improving over the time. Okay? Melissa has a question too. Say you directly modify the histone, you put this like a, just one gene in an expression vector, you add the mark or not the mark, you can see whether gene expression changes, right? Later on, you know, nowadays people also say if I have an enzyme that does the writing or erasing, if the writing or erasing is not there or there, does that change gene expression? And so over time you figure out. The early experiments were done actually in a very biochemistry way, or one at a time, just one location, one gene, to see how it works. Now we have genomics, we're learning this much faster. Okay? Other questions? All right. So another way histomark can be useful is to identify new genes in the genome. So if you, maybe we don't restart the tutorial yet. Yeah, so in this new, in this study, this is actually John Ren's early study. They were trying to find these non-coding RNA. So these are genes that can make an RNA, but the RNA cannot make into a protein. It's just an important new gene in the genome. And the reason they did it is, so they did the H3K4 trimethylation, which marked the beginning of a gene, and the K36 trimethylation, which marked polymerase elongation, right? And so they see in this case, okay, this region is a known gene, and this region is a known gene, and in the middle it's supposed to be nothing, right? Nothing's supposed to happen. And then you see a region where it has H3K4 trimethylation, and you even see the K36 trimethylation. That would mean there's a gene here, it's a new gene that people didn't know before. Right? And it's going in this direction because the promoter and the gene body, right? This one is, let's see. Yeah, this is another new gene that people didn't know. This is a promoter, and this is kind of gene body. So you can use it to identify these new genes in the genome. Another one is, people are using it. Remember, we say there are many genes in the genome. Which ones are the more interesting ones? So what people found over the years is the important genes or interesting ones, the cell has to make sure they are under tight control. They need to be either, so for example, if you have to change the gene expression of a gene with only one tune, like a yes or no, right? So say this is an activator mark. If you only have one mark, it's either high or low, this gene will be just up and down, right? But if you also have a repressive mark, it's the up minus the suppressive, then you can fine tune this a little better. And those genes are called the bivalent genes. They have, you know, two marks in there. And very often genomes that have these bivalent, you know, one active and one suppressive together, those are the more important genes in the genome. And so this was also discovered by Brad Bernstein at Harvard. Back in 2006, they did the histomark chip-seq in embryonic stem cells. And in those cells, they see a lot of genes having both the H3K4 trimethylation, which is active, and also H3K27 trimethylation, which is repressive. And then they see, you know, normally these are not going together. But in embryonic stem cells, they see, oh, these genes, you know, in the promoter region have both marks there. Interestingly, these genes in the embryonic stem cells are not active, they are being suppressed. But it's actually a flag to tell us these genes are going to be important later on. A lot of the genes in here are developmental genes. Once the embryonic stem cells start to differentiate, a lot of these, then the active become more, the repressed become less, and this gene will be turning on, right? very beautiful. And then depending on the, you know, how the two gates are coordinating with each other, the different genes are getting activated in the different differentiation pathways. Okay, so the bivalent tool is kind of a way to help you figure out which genes are potentially interesting. Right? Another type of histomark is actually based on H3K27 acetylation. Turns out these three things, BRD4, MAD1, and PO2 on the promoters are similar. On the enhancers, this one also goes to more of the enhancers. So this was a study. Oh yeah, this is a related study. Globally, if you look at enhancers, you know, this is a transcription factor binding. You see some enhancer, but then there are other regions that are actually Rikyong and MIT defined this as a super enhancer. So you can see the transcription factor binding is still pretty sharp, but look at the histomarks around here. It's high and wide. And sometimes this can last for like 50 kb regions. And very often these things also overlap with the beginning of a gene. It's like when this gene is so important, you use the epigenetic mark to tell you this gene is important. And so sometimes the expression of this gene, but usually the super enhancer genes are expressed, but they may not be super overexpressed. If you don't look at the epigenetic mark, you may not know that this is super important. So in some sense, in addition to upregulating their gene expression, the cell is trying to use epigenetic to reinforce the expression, to make sure that this region is going to be, you know, you keep this region open, you want this cell to always make this gene, which means a lot of these genes are potentially important cancer drivers. And if you can get rid of those genes, you nail the disease on the head. And so you can see here, so this is the original super enhancer paper. So this is a beginning of a gene. Typical enhancer just bind to a small location and the K27 signal is weak. But on the super enhancer, when the transcription factor binding is still sharp, the K27 acetylation can be really widened and tall. And if you look at all the K27 acetylation ChIP-seq, like a read or signal, you can see some genes having this kind of designated super status. And so, for example, in the embryonic stem cells, they are using MAD1 here, but you can also use K27 acetylation. In embryonic stem cells, a lot of these top, you know, number 1, 2, 3, 4, these top genes are all well-known embryonic stem cell markers. So the epigenetics is helping to make sure that this gene is so important, let's keep it open, let's keep it expressed. Okay? So that's also a... So histomark is just flags waving to say this region is important, make sure we protect it. Or this region needs to be actively managed so that it doesn't turn out when it doesn't need to be turned out. Okay? So you can see later on, also Rikyong's group published papers will show a lot of these master transcription factors are important in establishing the super enhancer, and they are the key cell identity genes. And also, super enhancer control the cell identity and also disease. And so you can see why people now want to do H3K27 acetylation profile, because it tells you where the enhancers are, it tells you which genes are active, it can also tell you which genes are more important than others in that cell. Okay, that's some interesting work. So recently there is a drug that is an epigenetic drug which targets BRD4. This actually targets the histone acetyl reader. And this has been tried in patient cancers. They actually work on some very interesting cancer types. And then so when they treat the cell with this drug, they found, turns out, it targets the super enhancers, prove particularly sensitive to this inhibitor, this drug. Because actually initially the super enhancer definition is, BRD4, MAD1, and K27. It turns out the inhibitor that inhibits this, it's really targeting a lot of the super enhancers, which makes the cell not so happy. The very important lineage identifying genes and also the cancer driver genes that has this. And so when you target the cell with this drug, you'll just kill the important genes. Kate?
Yeah, if you're using that in a medical situation, like, would that be a drug that you would take? And then if you did that, and it's in its targeting this, and that's an important gene, like, isn't that going to be bad?
Yeah, this is an excellent question. We will also talk about cancer epigenetics in a later section. Interestingly, in cancer, people found a lot of mutations on the epigenetic regulators, whether it's a reader or writer or eraser. So pharmaceutical companies are developing drugs against these mutated genes. And then when they treat the cell, very interesting, this is what they see. Normal cells don't care. Doesn't matter. The cancer cells are dying left and right. I think actually, in some sense, epigenetic help to maintain the balance. Normal cells know exactly where it is going. It's already very stable. And so when you treat them with epigenetic drug, the transcription, so in some sense, it says transcription factor and the transcriptional event are the more important thing. Epigenetics helps. Right? And so if transcription is very stable, very normal, epigenetic doesn't sway it so much. But cancer cell is like you're skiing down a ski slope and you got in a ditch, right? Like the cancer cell is not very stable. It's like, oh, you know, trying to maintain its balance, trying to grow, you know, like crazy. And now you give it a drug, you will really push it over the edge. And that's so far what people found. The epigenetic inhibitors mostly just work on the cancer cells, even though all of these marks are important in the normal cell as well. It's like magic. So yeah, very puzzling. So this drug basically just hit a lot of the super enhancers. And recently, there's another study that's published in Nature Genetics. They found this super promoter. So H3K trimethylation is a promoter signal. And normally you see these peaks right on the promoter. But then some of these genes have a, you know, like this is a very, so these are the normal promoters, but this is like a super promoter. Right? It's a very, very wide and very, very tall. And when they look at the genes around there, they saw a lot of these as tumor suppressors. Now, what are tumor suppressors? They are highly expressed to suppress cancer cells. Usually they prevent the cell from growing like crazy. Okay, and so they need to be expressed. If you get rid of these genes, the cell will grow like crazy, and it's actually not good for the cell. And so then you can see here, if you look at the peaks in general, some are broad and some are sharp. These really broad ones, you can see, you know, like, if you look at every H3K4 trimethylation signal, align all the, so each row here is one gene. You align all the genes on here. Most of the transcription starts that have, you know, the active ones have this H3K4 trimethylation signal. They are pretty sharp. But then look at these genes. They are really, really wide. And if you look at, you do a gene ontology on these, a lot of tumor suppressor genes there. They have to be expressed. Otherwise, the cancer cell goes crazy. Very puzzling. You know, so in some sense, all of these marks tell you, so this is another broad peak, and it's kind of important for, turns out these really broad peaks are important to maintain the gene expression, and they found in the cancers, very often, it's becoming shorter, the gene cannot maintain its gene expression in the cancers. Yeah, so that's histomarks. Okay, questions about histomarks? Eugene.
On the last slide, why are the sharp ones housekeeping?
Huh?
No, the one before that, sorry. Yeah, is the sharp ones or housekeeping genes?
Well, there are a lot of, so first of all, some of these K4 trimethylation, a different lineage could be no mark at all, or sometimes has mark. The ones that are consistent and not too broad, these are the, I guess, standard genes. Just they always have this mark at the promoter, and they are not that broad. And so it's kind of magic how over evolution the cell figure out how to use these marks to figure out which locations are important, which are accessible, which regions attract transcription factors, which ones suppress transcription factors, and to control how genes are maintained. And so this really